goes right through. Puts on the slip again. Hard goes, Freddie. That was magnificent stuff.
Welcome back to the Advantage Line Punters. And it is a pretty sad week in rugby league. One of the game's icons, one of the game's most influential figures, a player, a coach, a power broker for the better part of half a century, Bob Fulton, passed away on Sunday. Fisky, Manly through and through. Bob Fulton aside for a brief stint at the Roosters, but you'd struggle to name a more influential figure over the last 50 years, wouldn't you?
Absolutely right. On and off the field, he was involved rugby league for that whole time, and not just involved, but highly influential, whether he's coaching Australia, coaching Manly, influential selector and involved in the back ends of Manly Warringah, but then as a player, did everything you could do and was an immortal. So it was a polarising figure, but as this week's shown, he was a popular figure, but more importantly, super influential, like you say. So he's a loss and incredibly private man. He didn't sort of let on that he was crook and sort of took everyone by surprise.
Yeah, it's certainly not the same outpouring of emotion as when Tommy Radonikis died, a figure who was universally loved. It would be hard to say that Bob Fulton was universally loved. He was very popular among those who were close to him. We've seen that from the likes of Ray Hadley and Phil Rothfield and many of his players, including Spud Carroll and a few of those. But you wouldn't call him widely loved or revered, Paul. But hard to argue that the stamp he left on the game hasn't been immense.
Oh, he had a huge impact on the game. I just wonder, is the reason or part of the reason that he's not as loved as much as Tommy was, because he played the bulk of his career and coached the bulk of his career with the Manly Sea Eagles, and Tommy was from sort of like the working class Western Suburbs Magpies and the Newton Jets.
I think it would
have hurt.
This strikes the Australian psyche in that Bob Fulton was always in control. He was a winner. Everything he did, he was at the top of his game. Even when during the Super League war, he made sure that the ARL won the little battles he was involved in. He made sure that his radio station was number one. He made sure Manly were getting every possible advantage. So it goes to the Australian psyche with the underdogs and the battlers. He was never an underdog. He was never a battler.
Bob Fulton stacked the deck in Bob Fulton's favour every time. Like, people were going to review him and rightly so, his record speaks for itself. But, but things weren't going well for Bob Fulton. Bob Fulton got out, could be blamed on him. If we remember Manly in 98, or the Northern Eagles, they'd lost their first eight games of the year and Bozo just walked away. He got out before he could cop that. He knew which way the winds were blowing. He was very, very good. And this is no knock on him, but he was very, very good at that. He was a tough, hard man. Yeah, he's from the old school. Just as Tommy was, but he never had that larrikin about him.
I think probably a human side to Bob Fulton, which we haven't heard a lot of this week. I heard the Progressive Rugby League podcast a few weeks back where they did an expose or an interview with Ian Roberts, famous Australian rugby league player who hit the heights of rugby league, but was also the first Australian sportsman to come out as openly as a gay man. And he actually had a story about Bob Fulton on the 94 Kangaroo Tour, it might have been, and they had a rule where partners could come in one night a week or something like that to the hotel, and there was all the rules. And he brought Ian Roberts into his office one day, and Roberts didn't know what it was about. He was a bit concerned, and it was sort of a secret that most people knew about, that he had his partner over with him during the tour. And Bob Fulton stood up, shook his hand and said, "Your partner's entitled to the exact same rights as the guys that have wives and girlfriends, and I want to make sure he's at every event that's possible." And Ian Roberts didn't see it coming. He's forever grateful that he felt accepted and part of the team, and his lifestyle was accepted. And Bob Fulton was ahead of his time in that regard. So it's worth calling that out. I think not many people know that story. And Ian Roberts, forever grateful. And, so he was a hard man, but he was also a fair man.
Absolutely tremendous story, that one. some other bozo stories before we get into it. Paul threatened to throw get a cement truck to run over Bill Harrigan. I think for most Australians, with the benefit of hindsight, the great shame is that he didn't do it.
I think a lot of them would have helped pay for the rental of the cement truck.
quite remarkable. It was Fiske Bozo using his position as New South Wales selector for many years to pretty much act as a recruitment and retention tool for Manly. See Jamie Bure, see Dylan Walker.
Yeah, I don't think it. I think Mark Carroll didn't even hide it on Sunday footy on TV. He was sort of saying if it wasn't for Bob Fulton, I wouldn't have made Australia. So given that he was Manly coach at the time and promised him that, they used to promise, I think during the Super League war, he went around and trying to recruit Ricky Stewart and a few others to the ARL, and they had Ricky Stewart until he backflipped. And he was going around with the promise you'll be Australian captain. And Ken Arthurson had to tap him on the shoulder and said, are we going to have 10 Australian captains here?
Once again, he was ahead of his time. Because they have co-captains on a number of sports teams these days.
He was good. I'll give him that. He was pretty tied up with Arca, or had been tied with Arca for a long time through his Manly career, and certainly learned how to wield influence and power. Was a pretty key figure during the Super League wars, as you guys have mentioned, but was also a pretty key figure in building that Manly side up in the late 80s. But then in particular in the 90s when they only got one premiership out of it, but they made three grand finals on the trot, Manly. They were the dominant side from 95 to 97, no question about that. And built a side kind of by tapping into the New Zealand base. Yeah, they had a lot of great Kiwis come through them then. So he did a particularly good job there, Bob Fulton.
It's fair to say, Paul, that Manly are a lot of Kiwis' second team, aren't they?
Very much so. And it probably goes along with the fact that Graham Lowe was coached there for a little while as well. But, yeah, and there were a number of Kiwis that went over there, Matthew Ridge, Craig Innes, I think Kevin Iroh came over from the UK and did a little stint there as well.
Darryl Williams?
Darryl Williams at fullback before that, yeah.
I think it was you, Toby Paul, before the Warriors go to the Cup, Manly were New Zealand's most popular team and Canterbury weren't far behind. And after that, big gap.
Yep.
New Zealand. So obviously the Bulldogs had a pretty strong pipeline into New Zealand. Anyway, Manly come away with a big win on Sunday.
Wow.
To pay homage to Bob Fulton. They beat the old rivals Parramatta. It was Manly been very impressive this year. It was probably Manly's most impressive win, would you say, Fiske, since it was probably as impressive as Scott Fulton's contract after the Super League war.
Yeah, I actually had this down. I found the game thoroughly enjoyable. I thought this was one of the best games of the year. I think it's definitely Manly's best performance, if not one of the most impressive performances. Because, yes, okay, Daly Cherry Evans and Tommy Turbo are really just untouchable at the moment. Like, Tommy is in – this is – we're talking Jared Hayne 2009 form here. He is – just at the top of his game, and let's not talk too much more about it because everyone can see it. But the other players, the support players, like your Kepis of the world, your Josh Schuster's, Ruben Garrick showed some pace I didn't know he had. Brad Parker's, that pickup at full pace, a metre out from the line, I thought, Brad Parker, that's just, that was a one shot. He can't catch him on his chest. So
I would have laid anyone, any price that was a try in real time.
Yeah.
It's like he's dead. Brad Parker can't catch that.
Yeah, and then Tapau's finding some form that we thought had left him for good. Same with Jake Trbojevic. It was just an all-round performance, and it just showed that rugby league played correctly, and I thought Thursday night was in this basket as well. Refereed and played correctly under these new rules, it still can be a brilliant game, and it still can be a tough game.
Rugby league's as tough now as it ever has been.
Just the Saturday night bizarre effort can sort of put – a bad taste in everyone's mouth, but I actually think the product standing on its own, especially Thursday night, like that traditionally, a Cowboys at home to Knights would always be a dud game. This that was brilliant game for just the neutral observers. And I thought Sunday Arvo was amazing game of footy.
Absolutely ripping game of footy. I'm particularly impressed by young Josh Schuster. I think his ball playing for a big fella is highly, highly impressive. So
Foran doesn't get back in, surely.
I wouldn't be playing Foran. I wouldn't play Foran in the first place. So I'm not sure he gets the contract. He's the jammiest bloke in the world.
Schuster should. He's a big lad, but he's got some silky skills. He sure does.
Very impressive. I thoroughly enjoy watching him play. And also, Tommy Turbo has scored in 6 straight games now. The record of the modern era is 10 straight games. Phil Blake scored in 10 straight.
Wow. 83.
For the Bunnies?
All 83. Oh, now we're in Manly. And the record all time, my good friend Aaron Wallace at Fox Sports thinks is Fred Totti in the mid-30s, scored 15 on the trot. So still got a way to go, but good Fred Totti reference anyway. On the other side of that Manly coin there was
Parramatta. I think the headline the next day was Hot Toddy.
very good. Was a very disappointing Parramatta Eels. So before we get into the Eels, just a shout-out to the Advantage Lions' probably youngest listener, our good friend young Jack Saville, 85 years old. Probably this is entirely unsuitable content, so shame on your father for letting you listen to this, but big shout-out to young Jack over in, of all places, Las Vegas, Nevada.
Hello, Jack. It's Uncle Fizzy. Yeah.
Hello, Jack.
Hey, Jack.
We all miss you, buddy. Hope you're enjoying Vegas. Make sure your dad listens to this part because we're about to tear shreds off the Parramatta Royals. Parramatta. I reckon they've been on the slide for a few weeks now. And I thought their performance was against the Warriors was concerning, particularly after that hot opening 15, 20 minutes. They were dreadful the other day. They should have lost by more.
I think what it was, Ted, and even the Roosters game, they got away with it. Roosters were reading their plays really easily. Like, it's not a sophisticated game plan.
Nah, Parramatta are very predictable, right? Like, Parramatta have the athleticism and they're well coached enough to just always beat bad teams, right?
Yeah, that's
right. They will do it on pure athleticism, pure, like, talent.
Oh, but, size and strength, too. Like, yeah. The two best props in the game this year have been their two starting props. Now, what they lacked and where they got lucky against the Roosters, they had 3 tries from kicks. Very could have gone either way on a number of occasions, and then Roosters had a few carried off and Radley hurt. So that was – they got lucky there, and then they – last week, Manly was just one step ahead of them. These left players, these block players to the left, and he doesn't have a play to the right. It's just a kick. They actually don't go to the right at all in attack, apart from an attacking kick on the last, and they find that sort of – that area on the edge between the wingers and the middles. And he's been placing the kicks well, but outside of that, if plan A and plan B don't work, there's no plan C, none.
Yep.
Whereas the subtle skills, I think when Manly were down to 12 at one point in the first half, they ran a play to the right where the actual the tactics of running plays inside, outside, and then they picked a runner up from behind was brilliant.
I love that. Pure football.
It was pure football. Like, no one knew where the ball was going. He had 3 options. The defence were bewildered. And
he looks behind him and throws the flat at the line, or he goes at the, like, it's all happening. Runners in motion.
Skill set Manly have got. It's the skill set Penrith and the Storm have got. And when Souths are actually going forward, they can do it too. But Parra don't have that. Parra, just what you see is what you get. Meat and 2 veggies. That's kind of it.
Another thing that's very disappointing, you find it hard to really make a case that they will be playing in the grand final this year. South Sydney, 2 50-point losses in 3 weeks. I know there's excuses probably for both of them, but golly gosh, they were disappointing on Sunday. Paul.
How many times has a Wayne Bennett coach side had 50 points put on them on back-to-back weeks? That
wasn't back-to-back. There was a game in between. They beat the Sharks last week.
Oh, they did. Sorry. So 2 out of 3. That you just don't get that. I know they've had injuries, and they've missed a few key players, but they have just looked absolutely terrible. I know Walker's had to play one with Mitchell out. Cam Murray's not been there all the time. They've missed some key players. Cook is just a shadow of himself. It's almost like he's playing in a blue and white jersey again. They're just, I don't understand it, because they've got all the bits and pieces there, even when they've got some missing. So it must be very, very concerning for the Rabbitohs, because at the moment there are two teams that are head and shoulders above the rest, the Storm and the Panthers. And at the moment, I've got the Sea Eagles as my third-ranked team. The mix that they have at the moment is just sensational, and the football they're playing is brilliant.
Yeah,
I'll tell you how to make the finals in the at the beginning of the season. I was feeling a bit worried for a while there.
Titties, mate, he's nailed it. And I think what you find about South, they're probably living proof that even in the game, as quick as it is and being accused of touch footy, you still need good big men in the middle. And South, that's what they're lacking. Penrith have got the big men going forward. Melbourne are just, they're just pushing up off the bench and in the pack. But South Sydney, like this week, Wayne knows it. He's dropped Liam Knight. He's dropped Jaden Sewer from the whole squad. He's dropped Tom Burgess. So as a number of forwards, he's not just put on notice. He said, I've had enough. I've had a gutful. You're just not doing what I need. And this was an unheralded pack anyway, where Boso Jr. Totola were playing above their probably ability from many people's minds. And now they're not. They're battling. It's that middle. It's they need those middle and edge forwards to find something. And even with Murray back, I think they're one or two short.
Yeah. I don't know what to think. I'll be interested when I was with Cameron Murray there, but their middle, they've got a very soft underbelly. A team without a soft underbelly, Melbourne Storm, they were missing their best four players, their best four Storm, well, at least their starting four spine players last week, and still put on 34 against the Raiders and covered the line. That's 2 weeks on the trot. I backed the Storm early, got the wrong line, moved by 6+ points, and I've had to hold on, haven't chopped out, and they've gone and covered, God bless them. I absolutely love the Melbourne Storm.
Yeah, and not only the best four players, like you said, their spine, like both halves. Like this is
and their fullback and their hooker.
Yeah, this is unprecedented.
Like everyone's talking about how well Penrith are going, they're obviously flying. Melbourne are going better. Now, this Melbourne performance this year has been, I've never seen anything like it, to be honest. Like, they could just roll at anyone. They could roll us three out and they'd still be winning games by 30.
Yeah, it was. I don't know how they're going good, not that good. I tell you what, there's a bit of Teddy, Nick Tedeschi, I mean, about George Jennings on the weekend, still all over the shop, but he still gets a run every week. And
Remus Smith, superstar.
Yeah.
Nico Hines.
But, you know, Brandon Smith was probably the top two players in the field. Nico Hines was the best. And it was only 3 or 4 weeks ago he wasn't even getting into the 17.
It's just unbelievable how this kept rolling and stuff out. Like, I don't know, what do you do for Nico Hines? Like, they're talking, we're talking big money at the Broncos, Canterbury, Canberra, a lot of clubs chasing him. Do you just stay and cop what you get?
And keep
stay,
winning.
And keep winning, and like, he'll find a spot for you in the centres or something like that? Like, I don't know.
Ask Nick Cottridge.
I don't know if Ricky was making Cottridge any better.
Yeah,
I don't know if the Raiders are going much better, but it's a Storm and it's Bellamy. Just like
I think Nico hails from Sunshine Coast, a school teacher by trade. I think Broncos would be a good fit for him personally.
Certainly not a hairdresser by trade, based on some of the looks he's rolling out with.
If you're an administrator or a coach of any sort of sports team, you go and visit the Storm, don't you? And you see what sort of systems they have in place.
Paul.
Hey?
Incorrect. Or what? If you're a bad club like Canterbury, all you do is go and try and pinch Broncos reserve graders and maybe pick up the dregs of the Penrith Panthers because your coach used to be an assistant there. Please. Oh. No, that's what a good club would do, Paul. You're spot on there. The big talking point of the weekend was no doubt the Roosters-Broncos game. I've been going on all week about what an amazing record it was. Phil Mickelson winning a major at the age of 50. Incredible stuff. But Victor Radley getting put on report four times in a single game. One, incredible that he did four acts of foul play. Two, how he didn't get sent off is beyond me. Like, amazing, amazing stuff by Victor Radley Fisky.
Well, I think I said last week that not only the smarter teams better at footy, the smarter teams are less likely to do these stupid head highs and leave their team short. Victor Radley said, Fisky, hold my beer. He basically did everything that a smart club and the smart coach at Trent Robinson would think is the right thing to do. And then, not only that, I thought, oh, Rob, I'll pull him aside here. No, he doubled down after his judiciary hearing saying, I'm not changing my style. I'm sorry. He lost the plot on Saturday night. He caught unlucky, lucky. He hit the bloke high twice. Some of those tackles late, and James Graham was saying it, when you go in with the wrong shoulder into a tackle, you know that you're just running on adrenaline then. You're running on temper and frustration. And at that level, you shouldn't be motivated by frustration. You need to be professional at all times. And if I'm playing Victor Radley, when he gets back from suspension, I'm having a big chat to him going, mate, you can't leave a short anymore. You have to drop your hips a bit lower. And that's just the discipline you need now. One of probably the biggest risks taken by a coach this year is the Bulldogs starting Jack Hetherington this week. He is odds on to get into the bin, I'd say. Odds on.
It's hard to disagree. And I thought it was exceptionally poor by Radley to come out and make those comments.
Yeah,
after the game, right?
You've got to smarten up. And log or lump it, these are the rules. And Brad Fittler, we know the game's in crisis when he makes smart comments. He said, I never thought hitting people in the head was a highlight of our game anyway, so I've got no problem with the rule. Hitting people in the head was never, ever something that attracted people to rugby league. Apart from a biffo, that's a bit different.
But we all miss that. We all miss that.
We all miss that. But head high tackles, if you penalise them now a little bit harsher than used to, move on. Get
built. I'm sick of people saying these are new rules. These are not new rules. These are rules that are just being enforced, but they haven't been for the last 20 years. So I applaud the NRL for this. And you know what? Fans are enjoying it too. It was the second highest rating game of all time.
Of all time. 500,000 people. And
On pay television.
That's right, which is unheard of numbers. So, well, it's been heard of once before. It was the second highest. But I do think the one thing about these send-off rules, it just gives these rubbish sides a hope that if you do everything right, you can potentially bank on one or two occasions during a match you're going to have 13 on 12.
Yeah. If you can keep 13 on the field, you're a chance to be one or two men up.
Yep. Yeah. At any given time. So a good side will do that.
And teams have to factor this in that it's going to be like ice hockey, where that's just going to happen in a game and you've got to minimise it and be careful about it. But that's just going to – there's going to be times when you've got an advantage or disadvantage. It's just the way it's going to be.
So yes or no, Teddy, has Trent Barrett at any time in the last fortnight trained with 13 on 12 or 12 on 13 to practice for either? Because it doesn't look like it every time we've had an extra man.
Have Canterbury trained? 2 weeks. Unclear. I'll tell you what we haven't trained at. Defence. I don't know if you saw. I pulled up some stats over the weekend, which I'll pull out now. Just some stats about Trent Barrett. In 8 of 11 games this year, Canterbury have conceded at least 28 points. In 29 of 73 games at Manly, Barrett's team conceded at least 78 points. In 15 of his last 28. In 15 of his last 22 NRL games, Barrett's teams have conceded at least 28 points. Barrett's defensive rankings in four seasons as a coach, 12th, 11th, 16th, 16th. The average score conceded by Trent Barrett across his whole career, 24.39 points a game.
Yeah, it's not good enough.
There's no hope. Like the best teams, the teams who make grand finals are the ones who defend well. Like, there's no excuse for Canterbury to be defending as badly as that. Like, the tackling's bad, the reads are bad. It's a soft underbelly, extraordinarily poor.
Defense is attitude, and it always has been.
Yep.
You can make up for poor skill sets if you've got a good defensive side, one that works quickly off the line. And I'll tell you, one side is actually doing that. They're not blessed with a lot of talent, but they're playing a game at pace, and that's the Cowboys. They're getting off the line quickly. They're showing a little bit more there, but at least they're in games and they're putting in. And that's that's what the Knights aren't doing. That's what the Dogs aren't doing. And to an extent, the Titans aren't really doing it either.
Well, I think the Bulldogs used to do that under Dean Pay. Offensively, they offered very little, but defensively, they actually got up off the line quite quickly.
And I can't believe I'm yearning for Dean Pay. That's how good we're going. I'm talking of toughness and attitude. Fissy, I'm sure you've got some views on the attitude and toughness of Canberra halfback George Williams. I know it was one of your favourites. Was being the operative word in this one.
Was. He can get on the next flight to Heathrow and we can be done with him. I think he's handled this very poorly. It's been poorly advised. My intel at the Raiders suggests that he's brought a few of these problems on himself and then he's sulking about it and didn't know which way he's going. And to come out last night saying, I didn't ask for a release and the club have left me high and dry, I think that's weak. And he's been pushing for this all year, make no mistake. And Raiders had no choice but to act. They've got Sam Williams, who's a loyal clubman.
I love Sammy Williams.
And they've got Jack Whiten back. And I'd rather a team of 17 tryers than 16 tryers and one bloke that just doesn't want to be there. So on your bike, and you've let yourself down, George. I'm happy to see the back of him.
Yeah, I thought it was completely grubby to hide behind this mental health reasons, stuff like that. And then to come out and say he didn't want it immediately. Well, you just want to get paid till the end of the year. And, come on, you wanted a release? You got it. Now bugger off.
Exactly.
No worries. The Raiders need a serious rebuild. Don Ferner is not going to fire Ricky Stewart as a coach. That will not happen. So they've just got to get on with it, right?
So this game on Saturday night, I watch it closely. And we talked about how good Melbourne were. It wasn't just their brilliant skills. They absolutely turned the screws on this mob. They just didn't give them any field position. Every time Canberra had the ball, it was coming off their line. Melbourne gave them no cheap possession. And Canberra just couldn't go with them. Like that pack now, which was always a strength, Harira Naira, Louis, Emre Guler, Ryan James, Horsburgh, they're just slow. They're just not suited to the modern game. They're slow and they don't have an impact. They've got no pace whatsoever. Ryan Sutton and Whitehead are the only ones that have a bit of punch, and they're pretty slow too. It's a slow pack.
Bit of a rumour game, then, that two of the players that played with the Raiders on Saturday night were on the beers and on the punt on Friday afternoon at what used to be the old All Bar Nut in Canberra, Fisky, which we know very well.
We know very well, and, they're playing like it. It was I couldn't believe the lack of energy they showed in that last 30 in particular. They were trying. They just had nothing in the tank because Melbourne robbed them of 50 or 60% of it, but the other 40 is just they just don't have it. They're not fit enough. It's just a bad makeup of a side. It's just not a good-looking side by any means. I think they're very one-paced, and even when they're putting in, which they were, they just don't have it.
Yep, I completely agree with everything you've just said there. Just a few bits. Fast points before we get on to the games this week. Paul, Reece Walsh, unbelievable.
How good. And apparently available for Queensland Origin selection.
Is he?
He was on the list. So yeah. I'm not saying throw him in there, but you could do worse.
Paul, he'll have a tough decision to make soon.
What, Kiwis or?
Yeah, yeah. Kiwis or Queensland, and I dare say Josh Schuster might as well. But New South Wales, he's a Sydney boy, but obviously the son of the great John Schuster, Kiwi legend. So, yeah, hopefully the Kiwi power brokers are lobbying heavily for both of them.
Well, I hope the Kiwi power brokers are lobbying Australian Rugby League and saying, look, we're just another Pacific Island. And just slot us in there with Fiji and Tonga and Samoa. And, you know, they're available for State of Origin. Then they're coming back and putting on the black and white jersey.
Talk about a way to devalue the black and white jersey.
hold on. If anyone devalues international rugby, it's not New Zealand.
Talking about the black and white jersey, I was at Lidcombe Oval last week watching the Mighty Magpies. I think they won their eighth in a row in the New South Wales Cup. So good to see the Maggies doing well and playing at a lovely ground like Lincoln Oval.
There certainly weren't any of us hanging on the line being covered in that game at all this year.
Bang.
Not.
I'll tell you what, it's always a real shock to the system when you get to 5 o'clock on a Saturday afternoon, 6 o'clock on a Saturday afternoon, you realise your biggest bet for the day is on the New South Wales Cup.
But I was sideline ice, sending him through to Teddy, and we got the chocolate. So everyone,
there was definitely silence in the last 4 minutes, and real concern coming through from the Robin Hood Hotel in Orange. What are your favourites, Fisky? Essendon Masters. The SR experience is over.
Oh God, he was just horrendous, and I think the defensive way of the Titans sort of coincide with him there. It's a funny side now. They're teetering on in or out of the eight. I'm not prepared to back him in. Pat Herbert's back. He's a slight upgrade. No, I emphasise the word slight. So, they really need to lift this week against the Sharks. They need to put two together. And hopefully we never see SN Masters in first grade again.
Paul, the Chad kicks a winning field goal last week, gets dropped this week.
He's sort of on the same trajectory as a good friend who's going from the Broncos to the Cowboys, and maybe a little sooner than we all thought. I guess because Chad's on his way, they've sort of moved on from him, like most clubs would do.
Well, most clubs, except for the Mackay Cutters, which is where he'll be spending most of his time as an $800,000 halfback in the next 3 years.
Can we get on them?
I'll be honest. I can tell you right now. But that would make Chad about the sixth best halfback in the Queensland Cup, from what I can tell. Todd Payton is an idiot if he thinks Chad Townsend is worth that amount of money. You only get one Dallin Bond in your life, is what Kerry Packer was famous for saying. And Chad Townsend, I'm sure, says you only get one Todd Payton in your life. So
it's funny how is Scott Drinkwater playing so well. And, you know, if they uncovered another youngster in the halves, they might be scrambling to try and stop this move from happening, but it's too late. He's signed for 3 years, and it's a 3 or 4 years, whatever it was. He's done well, Chad, and I wonder if Fitzgibbon, even off the records, had any influence saying, look, I want to see how Moylan and Johnson go together before we decide to sign them for next year, both being off contract. I just wonder, given the Sharks' lack of governance, I dare say he probably is.
Before we get into the games, Paul, former Warrior, former Bulldog, never played for your team, Fisky, former Eel, former Storm, former Seagull, former Wicked Warrior, former, I don't even know where else he's been, Shark, Blake Green announced his retirement. Paul, to be fair, I thought he retired 2 years ago. So,
yeah. Didn't you want him to play for one more club? Wouldn't it have put him in some real...
I was very upset that he didn't.
Played at more clubs than Dave Dobbin. Fair dinkum. He's been around the traps a bit, but I thought he might have actually retired at half time last week because the second half was horrendous against the Cowboys.
He
basically said, "I'm done."
His performance said, "I'm done" before the words came out of his mouth.
All right. Let's get on to the games this week, last week's results, before we have a yarn with a good friend of the show, Big League Sweepstake Ambassador, the one and only Blake Ayshford. Looking forward to that chat. I'm sure we'll be plenty to talk about, including we'll be running through our Origin teams.
Can't wait to see what he's got to say, that's for sure.
Mm.
Yeah, can't wait. Who knows what that will be. Last week. Oh, I didn't want to look at results, and now I'm looking at the results sheet. I really don't want to look at the results. Minus 450 for the 10. Minus 202.50 for Paul. Why do you call yourself Scottie Pippen for some reason? I viewed him more as a Tony Kukoc, Luke Longley kind of deal, but anyway. And Fisky, minus 67.50.
I can see the Scottie Pippen reference. He's not build number one. He's not the number one, but he's the most valuable player in my mind.
Yeah. That's why I was going with a Tony Kukoc reference. A bit of Leo on the outside we could definitely do without.
I'm Luke Longley.
Solid.
That makes Teddy the security guard who was throwing coins up against the wall.
Oh, and you know what? I'm happy to say the greatest Chicago Bull of all time. That was some tremendous pennies being played at. I love his work. Best bets. To say we didn't get close would be an understatement. Fisky and I had -8.5 the Roosters, lost by 16 to the Broncos.
Jump -26, by the way.
We're on the right side of it. You can't eat odds, as I think you once told me, Fisky.
Yep.
Paul on the Rabbitohs +10.5. So it's hard to know who'd lost their bet earlier, but we know this went well. Multi-anchors. I had a three-way multi. Roosters, Storm, Sharks. Yikes. Lost. Fisky had Roosters, Storm at $1.24. Lost.
Good.
Paul had the Roosters straight out on the 12. Lost. Wowee. Roughies for the week. I had the Warriors 13+. And I got off the Eagles because you both had them and they both won at $2.95. So well done to you two. I've now 1-10 this year on Roughies. So yikes. The totals over 47.5 Roosters Broncos. Lucky open bet early punters. Because you got it. If you bet late, you missed it.
Yep.
50 made up 50 points and you went under the total. That's where the total's right now. I went the Sharks Dragons over. That went well. Finished 13-12. Well short of the 44.5 points. And over 45.5, Paul killed it very early on there.
What was that, Ken?
Cowboys Knights.
Yeah.
We got try time. Val Holmes. Yes. For Fisky, I had Bradman Best mercifully pulled out for something, and Val Holmes for Paul. So there we go. All right, this pod is shaping to be nearing as long, going as long as Roots. You remember that, Paul? Roots? Yeah, one of the great epics of television. So, yeah.
Your name is Teddy.
It's been a while between Roots for me, but yeah, I haven't seen it for years.
Rocky.
Oh God! I hope you're not listening, Jack.
Turn it off.
Absolutely gone. Oh wow, that was good. Best. Let's start with you, Paul. I think you're the most composed.
Well, you may not think that when I give you my best bet. I'm going Friday night. I'm going the Tigers -5.5.
Joke time was over with the Roosters. Yeah,
they have not been one of the best teams all season, but they are up against a Dragons team that is depleted by injury and suspension. I think the fact that the Dewey's now been in the centres for a week or two has just solidified that side of the defence. Leilua got absolutely stepped by RTS last weekend, but he's been he's out. So I just like the look of the Tigers side against the opposition that they faced this weekend. So I'm taking the Tigers -5.5.
Off your head. Fisky.
Yeah, I found this really hard. I was actually almost gravitating towards the Panthers taking the big minus. I think it opened 29, it's already got the 36, and I'm just gonna leave that go. I'm a bit shy after the Roosters game last
week. It's the biggest line since I've been keeping records in 2008. I dare say the biggest line, or at least in this century.
It's on par with a West game in 1999. So yeah, definitely this century. But it's only on par. It's not. I don't think West ever got bigger than a 36. So
this might start at 40.
It might. Like it's got a couple more in it. Maybe might get to 38, 39. The one thing about Panthers is that they're relentless. So you could just see them keep going. But I'm not going to go with that. I'm going to go with the Roosters again. And look, I know Radley's out. I know Crichton's out. This is more of a bet against the Raiders. They are really battling here. And the side, I know Whiten's back, but to a makeshift half pairing, they're just getting nothing from their three quarters. Their pack is slow. And with Hargraves, Takiaho, Nat Butcher did really well when he played the full game against Para a few weeks ago. I think there's enough there for them to just dominate the pace of the game. And with their halfback and Teddy there, I think they'll score a lot more points. So Roosters minus 11.5 for me. That's my best bet of the week.
Yeah, I like the Roosters there. Not my best bet, but I like that bet a lot. I'm just going to go with the absolute laydown, certainly moral best bet of all time. Melbourne Storm minus 20.5 against the Broncos. The Storm have won 29 of the last 34 against the Broncos. They are 21-6 against the spread since 2008, which is astonishing in itself. Average margin 16.7. Storm have covered their last 8 games this year. They've covered without most of their spine players most of the time. It's astonishing. Jerome Hughes back this week. Huge in. The Storm have covered 12 of 15 as a double-digit favourite on the road. They've covered 7 of the last 8 at Suncorp. They've covered 12 of the last 14 of scoring 30-plus. The Broncos covered just 6 of the last 19 at Suncorp off a win. I love this bet. Storm minus 20.5. Get in the queue now.
Good call, Ted.
All over. All right, let's go to our Roughie of the week. Have you got a Roughie that you like, Paul?
Yeah, this was pretty tough. In the end, I've gone with the Titans to win by 13 and over against the Cronulla Sharks at $3.10. I know they've been up and down this season so far, the Titans, but I think they're up against a Sharks side that's sort of lost their way a wee bit, now got an interim coach and Josh Hannay. I think they're already looking towards next season and how the team is going to shape up. So I think the Titans might be able to put a score on them here. So I've gone Titans 13 and over.
Fishy.
Yeah, this one just doesn't sit well with me, but I'm going to take it anyway. Newcastle they've been horrible this year, but they've named a very good side this week in comparison to weeks gone by. Ponga's back. Bradman Best is back. I think they might do enough at home to challenge Manly, who are red hot. But last week was an emotional win. They couldn't be playing any better. I just think my numbers come up a bit lower than the market. So I'm going to go on an alternate point start in this one. I just think Manly will probably get the chocolates, but looking down on it, if you can get the Knights here, I'm just looking at the appropriate alternate line. Here it is. Knights plus 4.5 at 250. That's my Roughie of the week.
All right. My Roughie of the week is the biggest favourite of the week, one of the biggest favourites of all time, the Penrith Panthers. I am taking them at minus 47.5 at $3.75. The Dogs have scored 0 points in their last 2 against Penrith. They will not be scoring this time. Penrith has scored 48 in their last three. Penrith win this by as much as they want. The Origin jersey's up for grabs, so you'd think they would be on song for a bit of it. I think this will get to 60 or 70, to be honest. So I will be taking the minus 47.5 at 375 as the Roughie of the week.
So, Teddy, just a quick one. On my ratings, listeners might be interested to hear. So there's no historic equivalent of a lopsided game like this in the NRL, but the only time there is in international league. And when you get sort of situations where, you know, USA play Australia or something like that, the average or the median winning margin for games like this is around 54. So it's in that league, mate. My numbers are 40, and that's trying to be a bit conservative, thinking, I don't know, I've just never seen it this big. I can't go any bigger. But, yeah, I think you're on the money there.
I asked a good friend of mine in Ratings Tragic and friend of yours, Lord Fisky, Stuart Dibb, at what number he could back the Bulldogs at. And it was at 42.5 was where you could back the Bulldogs against. You wouldn't feel good about it. But you could bet. I said I couldn't bet the Bulldogs under 48. If this line was 47.5, I couldn't take it.
I think 42.5 at even money is a bet by the traditional sense of the term, but not a big one. Like you said, wouldn't feel good about it.
Wouldn't feel good about it. All right.
Like hopping into a spa with Paul Mulati. You'd do it, but you just wouldn't feel good about it.
I hope there's room for Blake.
I hope there's room for all the diseases that are coming in with you, Paul.
Turn it off, Jack.
Multi-anchor. Paul.
I'm sort of going against Fiske here. I'm taking the Sea Eagles at $1.27. They are only just a notch or two below the Panthers and the Storm at the moment. They're just building very, very nicely. The team has some great balance. Tommy T just makes everyone else so much better, I think, because he creates so much more space for the rest of the team. And I just see the Sea Eagles continuing on after that big victory against the Eels last weekend. So Sea Eagles at $1.27.
Yeah, I know, Paul. My numbers have this one as could be close, but I know what you're saying. It's funny, this week you can't put Penrith as your lock of the week because the bookies have it 1.001.
We're not even taking a bet.
And probably rightly so, but you can get on the doggies at $17. Good luck to you there, guys. I'm just going to be real back to basics this week after last week's shocker. Melbourne Storm at $1.10.
I'm going the Melbourne Storm 13 plus at $1.40 as the moral of the week there. Total. Any totals you like? The numbers are well and truly getting up this week. The bookies may have caught up to the totals.
They've adjusted. They have.
25 of the last 32 have gone over. Are you finding some unders here, Paul?
I tried to. I've gone with another over, though. I've gone with the Knights Sea Eagles. Plenty of attacking ability on both sides in this matchup. I've gone over 51.5.
Yep. Biscuit.
Yeah, I think these days, if you're unsure where a total should start, I think your starting point is flat 50. I've done a bit of work on this. I think that's your starting point, and if it's a lower or higher scoring, you go either side. One game I think will be way higher scoring than that. It's a day game. It's at a nice soft track up in northern New South Wales. It's between two sides that think defence is something you put in front of the house. I love the Sharks Gold Coast over 50.5. I think this goes over and goes over by a fair bit.
Yeah, that's time surface here. I'm with you completely on that one. Overseeing three straight between these two. Huge over spot for the Sharks. 19.5 over when they're off conceding 14 or fewer. 15.8 over when they play day games. Over hits at 64% when the Sharks are 220 or less. The Titans have conceded 20 or more in six straight. They concede a record score against the Bulldogs, 20 points this year, the highest score this season. They can't tackle. The Sharks can't tackle. Yeah, this has got 40-30 written all over, especially if there's a couple of Simbins, right?
I'll just call out, good work, Ted, I'm the same. There's a couple that where you could lean into the unders, and I actually like the Paramanly under and took that last week. And I think there's one that comes up like that South Para this week. It's 50.5, and it's not an official play, but I think they could sneak under, personally. A night game at Homebush against two desperate sides.
Yeah, I could see the under in that one, for sure. I see the under in the Tigers, Dragons, too, just quietly. All right, what do we got left?
Try scorer.
Try time. Try time. Yeah. Oh, yep. Wow. Brisbane, Melbourne. Oh, wow, Paul. What a try time game.
There's going to be a few, I'd say.
Get in the queue. Talk about printing cash.
Is it worth calling out the try sweepstake?
Yep. Oh, yeah, yeah. Look, if you haven't registered, make sure you do. But
it's only two rounds to go.
What are we? Yeah, we're round 12 this round and next week as well. Your last two rounds to qualify for our NRL sweepstake. So for every game you place a $10 plus, anytime try score a bet, you'll earn an entry into the draw. And after week 13, we'll be doing the draw and 34 people will get drawn out and we'll have a chance to win that $40,000 bonus bet. There are plenty of other bonus bets to go around as well, but the person who gets the first try scorer in the state of origin one wins a $40,000 bonus bet. And if you haven't registered, don't worry, register now, and every qualifying bet that you've already had
since round one
will count.
Yeah, good stuff.
We have one bloke. He loves it so much. He's written us an email. Tells us he has 12 anytime try score bets a game. Good on you, champ.
Good on him. What a legend.
That's a try time game on Thursday night as well.
Your try time bets will count to entry as well.
Yes, because they're a place a pre-match anytime try score a bet of $30 or more, and you'll get a $5 bonus bet for every try scored in the match. And this week's match is the Brisbane Broncos Melbourne Storm. So if you have a $30 anytime try score a bet before the game starts, you'll qualify for the NRL try time, and you'll also qualify for the NRL sweepstake.
Well, would you bet anywhere else? So I'm going to go with another legend, Justin Olam, Papua New Guinean Kumul legend. He's on fire this year. He's not just solid anymore. He's an outstanding footballer.
He's been a real punish lately to poor old Ted, who's been with him every week. When he blew that Penrith game by not passing the ball and going himself, all he does is pass the ball now. And a casket. Sorry, if this was some kind of try assist time, I'd be all over Olam. He can have the line wiping just Olam. He just passes it.
Oh, actually, he's doing his best for Adokar, isn't he? He's been over the line at times and passed it.
No, it's killing me.
You know what? I'm allowed to change on the run, and I'm going to go with Remus Smith at $1.91. He's in some real great try-scoring form. He's basically having all his own way on the right-hand side of the field, and he's got no one to pass to out wide. So I'm going to go with Remus Smith at $1.91.
I like it. Paul?
Yeah, times two. I had Remus Smith written down already. He's making up for all the tries he didn't score in the blue and white jersey. He's doing it in quick time as well.
I'm down with my man, one of my new found. He's shortened up a bit this week, as you probably should. But Jerome Hughes scored tries in five of his last six games, $2.50. He just backs up well. He's always Johnny on the spot there, chases kicks through. And here's a tip. The Broncos aren't going to tackle him, so he'll have a field day.
Jerome Hughes played junior rugby league in Wellington City.
Oh, good on you. Where was his club?
It was called the Wellington City. Oh, it might be defunct now, but... it was called Wellington City Eagles or something along those lines. So, yeah, big shout-out.
Well done, Jerome Hughes.
Sounds like he was maybe eastern suburbs out or Lyle Bay sort of way. There was a rugby league park out there.
Oh, sorry, Harbour City Eagles.
Harbour City, yeah, that's them.
Where were they?
I think they played most of their games not far from the tip.
Oh, yeah. I know exactly what you're talking about.
Down the valley there towards the south coast.
Yep, yeah, I know it.
In Lyle Bay?
Not Lyle Bay, no. It's further round.
Island Bay?
Yeah, it's sort of down Happy Valley.
Oh, yeah, I know what you're talking about.
Yeah.
I don't. I'm just saying that to end this conversation.
Someone find Blake Ayshford, will you?
All right, fellas, we're going to take a small break and then we will be back with Blake Ayshford. And now introducing our guest, the one and only Blake Ayshford. We are 11 weeks into the big league sweepstake. Our man Blake is coming to a close pretty soon. Welcome back to the pod, Blake.
Thanks for having me, guys. I'm excited. Exciting times.
Mate, we are nearing Origin. We're going to get to Origin very, very soon. But, of course, Origin 1, we will be... will be a thrilling affair, particularly for 34 punters who will have their name drawn out and will be having a runner in the big league sweepstake. Like, that's huge.
Mate, it is massive. And the prize money, the bonus bets on offer are ridiculous. So I think there's a lot of people that have put the bets on but haven't registered yet.
Yeah, 22,000. Yeah. So get in there. There's nothing to lose. You've already qualified.
So hold on. They're already qualified. They've just got to register. Yeah,
exactly. So they've placed the qualifying bet. They just got to register. Just go to, I think it was www.sweepstake.co.nz and tabsweepstake.co.nz, sorry, and register, because, I mean, I'm going to be down there. I got a message off Fisky before. He's saying he's going to be down there, I think, Origin time.
I was about to say, there's not only a chance of winning a $40,000 bonus bet. You get to watch Origin 1 with Blake Ayshford, Matt Fisk, and probably Paul Mawadi, because yep. I don't know if Paul Mawadi's been invited, but he's never missed a free drink in his life.
Oh, mate, he's invited.
So there you go.
Blake needs a bodyguard. I'll be there.
Oh, mate, after 20 schooners, I know where it'll go. It'll be a great night. It'll be well.
If you're drinking with Fisky, Blake, 20 schooners is the entree.
Oh, I meant before kickoff. Before kickoff.
Remember, punters, gamble responsibly.
Yes, and drink responsibly.
Yeah, so get out there, punters, and definitely do register. You've got nothing to lose. If you get drawn out, you will have a chance of winning a $40,000 bonus. But if your player drawn out scores the first try in Origin 1, so that's a hell of an opportunity.
And also, so those punters who haven't registered but have qualifying bets already, those bets will count as soon as they register.
If you've got 100 qualifying bets from 100 different games, you are going to have 100 different tickets in the draw.
Exactly. And like I said, once it's drawn out, like, we'll send the email straight away, I'm pretty sure, where the drinks will be at. So everyone's welcome to come down and have a beer and watch Origin.
Absolutely. Bring a friend. You'll be right as rain. Now, we'll get to Origin just a tick. Blake, give us your view of how the season's going so far. It looks like a two-horse race at the moment. Is that fair to say?
Yes, I suppose so. But it's funny with the, you know, I didn't want to really talk about the new rules and things, but it's sort of out of the players' hands now, I think, who wins the game. I think when would we have thought the Broncos would have beaten the Roosters at the SCG? Never. But, you know.
My betting account certainly suggests never.
I've been meaning to ask, Blake, were you part of that? Was there a Sharks team 3 or 4 years ago that had a mighty upset over the Roosters at the footy stadium?
Possibly. I think I might have been dropped that game. So I think I was at the club then, though. Yeah.
Yeah, because I remember they said it's the biggest upset pretty much since that one. And yeah. I looked at the sides and, yeah, it was a spare parts Cronulla team, that's for sure.
That's when I think the whole side got depleted from the peptides.
Yeah.
Case. So, but I mean, that's what I mean. Like, this, the two horse race at the moment, you'd think so. But in saying that, I hope that it's not grand final day and then we come out talking about, I don't know, two players sin-binned. And that's the reason the game is decided. So, like I said, yeah, I don't know. I think it brings – the new rules bring everyone back into it, really. And even though South went down on the weekend, they're still one of my tips to take it out.
Yeah, they've conceded 52 of the last 3 weeks.
Yep. They went down big.
All right, let's get an Origin. That's what we're all here for today. We're all thinking about. So you're going to get the views of us four for who should be in the Origin series. We're going to start with the defending champs. We're going to start with Queensland here, punters. And I reckon we are pretty open, even at fullback, as to who's going to be picked. So Queensland fullback, Blake, who you got? You got Ponga?
Yeah, I've got Brimson. Ponga.
Yeah, I've got Ponga.
Yep.
I know, Fisky, you're a big AJ Brimson man. Are you sticking with Brimson or are you going to Ponga?
No, I think Palmer showed some good signs before he got injured, and he's too good to leave out, and I think he's only got one position realistically, and that's fullback.
Yeah, true. Paul, is that 4-4-4?
We've got a consensus. We do.
If there's word Munster's out, do we pong? Does that bring Brimson in? And
oh, you'd have to play Brimson. Well, let's get to the halves. I'm sure we've all got Munster and Cherry Evans to start with. Is that right?
Yep.
Munster's fit.
If Munster's fit, yeah. Assuming Munster's fit. If Munster's not, I assume Brimson comes to the halves, right?
Not for me.
I was different. I had Brimson in the centres. I've got Ben Hunt coming in.
Oh, interesting.
I've got Sam Walker.
Oh,
gee, that nice. Is the field.
I had Ponga at 6 and Brimson at the back. Munster's out,
I can see that. I can see that. I do think Munster will play. I don't think he needs to play for the Storm beforehand.
No,
to get a game. I think they'll bring him in. The three quarter line, I reckon this is wide open. I reckon all four spots are up for grabs, and I don't know that there's a lot of talent there to fill them. So, let's start with you, Blake. What do you got as your we'll start with your wingers and centers.
My wingers, I've gone Val Holmes and Xavier Coates.
Yep.
I think Xavier Coates, player of the future, actually. And I've gone Dane Gagai, who's the best player in Origin, seems every year. And I couldn't find another center, so I put Capewell in there.
Yeah, I've got exactly the same back line as you there, Blake. That's three quarter line. Capewell played well there last year, and you're not going to go with a Brinker, a Lee, or someone like that, right? So,
nah, I couldn't find another centre. I don't know if you boys had another centre.
I was stretching. I had Capewell.
That's up where I'm 4-4 there.
So I had 3-4, and I had Brimson in the centres. That was the only difference, but I can understand Capewell, and they probably will go with that.
Yeah, and I don't mind you thinking at all there, Fisky, in terms of essentially you just put the best 13 together and then find them a spot, right? That might be the way to go, Crimson, because he needs to be around there somewhere. We'll get to the bench soon enough. Hooker's interesting, probably a two-horse race, but Harry Grant, Reid Marnie. I've plumped for Harry Grant. Blake?
I've gone Reid.
Reid?
Just because I've got Grant on the bench, but I've gone for Reid just because Harry Grant, I don't know how many times he's played a full game this season, and Origin's a whole nother level. So I'd put Reid Marnie on to start the game, take the punch out of it, then after 20, he go bang, Harry Grant.
Makes sense. A bit like what they did with Jack Friend last year.
Yep.
That's exactly what I've done, Blake. I love it. I think Reid Marnie's been super resilient this year. He's been playing long minutes. He's been playing great footy. His kicking game's tremendous. And, look, I love Harry Grant. And I think he's a top footballer. I'm not sure he's got the minutes in his legs, particularly coming into this relatively fresh. So great to have on the bench. Can have both on the field at the same time, given Marnie's toughness. He can play like a 13 role. So, yeah, I'd definitely start with Marnie.
Yeah, I think that's an eminently sensible plan. Paul?
Harry Grant. I was just impressed with what he did last year in State of Origin. I know he doesn't have the minute, but he's got young legs.
Do you have Marnie on the bench there, Paul?
No, I don't.
Okay, interesting. Okay.
No.
Interesting. So no Marnie for you.
No.
Let's start with our props. I've gone with Christian Welch and Tino Fasalamoloi, which I've pronounced incorrectly. About halfway through there. Blake, what have you gone with as your
I've gone Christian Welch and Mo Fotuaika, the Gold Coast thrower.
Fotuaika is flying. That was a great try set last week. So
yeah, I think he's starting to. I think when he came in the other day with did they come in the background there? Sorry, I think when he came in the other day, this year he was trying to find his feet with Tino and Fifita, the big names coming to the club. But I think since then. The last couple of weeks he's been on fire.
Yeah, I thought Moe might have had his cards marked last year because he got dumped by Bennett and he was less than impressive at Origin level. But yeah, the last few weeks he's earned a bench spot for mine. I'm actually starting with Jai Arrow and Christian Welch, and then I've got Big Tino at 13, so the other middle.
Well, we've got the same because I've got Jai Arrow at 13 and Big Tino at there as well. Paul, props?
Yep. I've got Welch and Fasua Maliawi.
Yeah, right. So what about your locks to round out your middles there, Paul and Blake?
Fusi and Fifita and Jai Arrow.
Your middles, your Jai Arrow lock. Yep, and Blake?
Yeah, I've got Tino at lock, mate.
Yeah, so all reasonably similar there. You've just got most starting. Yep. And the edges, I've got Felice and David Fafita. Are we all?
Yep, I'm the same as that.
Yeah,
they were probably the two easiest positions to pick outside of DCE.
Yeah, I would have thought so. That's right. Yeah. The bench is interesting. So there's a lot of forwards who can play a lot of big minutes there for Queensland. So I've gone with Brimson, just that punch off the bench. Reid Marnie, I just love the can play that lock forward just defensive. He should take some of the heat out. Got Big Mo Fotuaika and Jaden Sewer. I think they're having a really good year for the Bunnies.
I've got Harry Grant in the 14. Obviously spoke about that. I've got Jaden Sewer as well. I think Jai Arrow can come on and play front row and in that middle as well. And then I think I've got Cohen Hess, who's been for the Cowboys. I think the last month the Cowboys have been on fire. He's been coming into the middle, playing front row, playing lock, and I think he'll do a job there. Big body. Yeah.
He's been much more effective there than he has been on the edge, that's for sure. This year.
Yeah, it's a really interesting talking point. I think Jaden Sewer got dropped this week, and Bennett hasn't just dropped him to the bench. He's dropped him to 18th, 19th man. So,
oh, wow.
I think he's made a statement there. He wasn't happy with his efforts last week. So I don't know how that's going to play out. So I've actually gone with Harry Grant on the bench. I've got Kurt Cable on the bench. I've got a fellow. So I was gone with Moe as well. And my last position, he's a bit unheralded, but I've really, really liked him this year. Josh Kerr from the Dragons.
Yeah.
Did he get dropped or was he suspended this week?
He's suspended. So he'll be back the week after. If he gets picked, I like him. I actually think he can play. He was a prop, a middle forward, and he's moved to the edge pretty effectively. I'd have him in over Sewer, personally.
Okay. Interesting. Paul?
I've got Ben Hunt as my number 14.
Yeah.
Fotuaika, Dynamis Louis, and Cohen Hess's teammate, Shane Wright.
Shane Wright, unheralded. I don't mind that selection at all there, Paul.
I just get the feeling that he's the sort of player, you put the maroon jersey on and he'll grow another leg.
They all are.
They all are, yeah. Unfortunately.
But, to be fair, that's true.
Unless you, even Brinko Lee looked good last year, so. There we go. All right, that is Queensland done and dusted. A fair agreement on fullback Ponga. We have mostly the same three quarter line. Munster is fit and Cherry Evans. A bit of playing around there. Welsh, unanimous. A bit of a split over hooker, Grant or Marnie. Tino in there, Jai Arrow in there, Felice Fafita. Everyone wants Mo Fotuaika there. Brimson's in there, everyone's side somewhere. Marnie's made three or four sides, and a bit of conjecture over that last bench spot. Sewer, Kerr, Welsh, bit of Dunamis Louis there. So,
Who would you, Blake? I'll go with you first. Who would you want to have if you had three players you were lucky enough to have in your sweepstakes? Who would they be in the Queensland team?
From the Queensland side, definitely Dane Gagai. I mean, I can't remember a game he hasn't scored for Queensland and has been the best there. I wouldn't mind one of the back rowers, preferably David Fafita or Val Holmes as well. Another one who scores every time he puts on that Queensland jersey. So those three for Queensland, I think, especially those outside backs grow extra leg when they play for Queensland.
And we just have a disproportionate ability to score a try. In Origin, just because the defences are so good through the middle. It kind of does get right out to the edge. Yeah, it's hard to go past. Gagai scored most of his tries on the wing.
Exactly.
But yeah. Xavier Coates, I think, scored one or two last year. And Val Holmes, he's much better as a winger than a fullback for mine.
And finding his form the last few rounds. I've been really impressed with him.
Yeah, it was a nice try scored last week.
Yeah.
What are you, Fissy? If you're pulling someone for a try score, anyone?
Oh, I had the exact same three: Gagai, Holmes, and Fafita. If I had any of those three, I'd feel on pretty good terms with myself.
Yeah. Would you already be counting the bonus bit, what you're going to do with it in the head?
I have been known to get ahead of myself, so yeah.
Counting the bonus bit, he's already planned the trip to Disneyland with all the cash he's got. And when I say Disneyland, I mean kittens. you South Wales. Paul, you've gone quiet. Paul Mawadi, can you hear me? Onto the Blues. I would suggest there's probably not a lot of conjecture in fullback, but bloody oath, we have a lot of great fullbacks in the comp at the moment. Can you go past Teddy?
No.
Got to stick with Teddy, don't we?
Yeah, you can't go past him.
You can't I don't think you can just because he can't play the other positions like the other players can.
Yeah.
Personally, right now, I don't think he's the best fullback. Oh, like at this very minute. I mean, I think the other fullbacks are playing better footy, but like when I say that, we hold him at a high standard. So, obviously, you know. But yeah, I agree with you all. I think Teddy will be there.
Did you play with Teddy at all? Did your careers cross paths?
Yeah, He debuted his debut game when he did his knee. I was
there at Leichhardt
against Cronulla.
Yeah, 2012, I think it was.
Did you know when he was coming through the grades that he was going to be a superstar? Or was he just really... Because he never looked it early on. He didn't seem that fast. He didn't seem like... He didn't seem like a prodigy like a Latrell Mitchell or someone was. He seemed to kind of come out of nowhere. Grew a leg.
He did, mate, because he didn't make any of the rep teams, did none of that schoolboy stuff, none of it, and then all of a sudden popped up in the 20s and was a freak. And... from then on, like, there was no way he wasn't making. Like, you watched him in the 20s and you're like, oh, this kid's good.
Yeah.
And to say that, what he's done since when he was been at the Tigers, I never thought he'd be this good. He was good, but the level he's taken the fullback position to has been amazing.
Yeah. Bit of thanks to Trent Robinson, I reckon, on that one as well. All right, I reckon we better just go through our three quarter line now because we could have any combination. I'm sure Josh Adokar is in everyone's side.
Yep.
Yeah.
Harder lockdown there. Let's start with you, Blake. Who have you got as your other three, your two centres and your other winger?
My centres, I've gone Latrell Mitchell to partner with Addo Fox on the Fox on the left.
Yep.
And I've got Tommy Turbo to partner with Brian Tor.
Exact same.
Yep, very nice, very nice. Paul?
Almost. I've got Mitchell with Addo Carr on the left, and I've got Tommy T partnering up with Whiten.
Ooh.
Okay. I one thing I'm not that fond of, and I'm picking Matt Burton to play centre on the left. I reckon he is absolutely flying at the moment, and I'll be very happy to put him over there. I've got Tommy Turbo on the right wing. I'm playing with Latrell Mitchell. I'm a bit concerned about playing Latrell on the right, but I don't think Jack Whiten's going well enough to play Origin. I don't think he's got a big enough legacy in Origin to demand a spot. So I'm more than happy to leave him out. So kind of a little bit off book there.
Ted, I'm with you on that point around Whiten. I think, let's not forget, New South Wales lost the series last year.
Yep.
So any talk of being loyal to players last year is off the mark. Yep. He actually had two of his worst games for the season, in what was a brilliant season, in Origin. I thought he was terrible in games one and three in particular. And I guess that's why no one's talking about Parramatta fullback, Gutho, because he also let the side down, I thought, in game three. So Whiten's kind of had a bad Origin series rolled up into a pretty ordinary season. So I don't think they owe him anything.
Yeah. I'm with you there.
I've gone the reason I went Brian Tor is just because I think we've seen Tupou last year do a great job coming out of the backfield, and I think this bloke's taking it to a new level. He's that hard to tackle. I think – get the set started, he'll be unbelievable. And the reason I just didn't put Burton in only because I think Mitchell's been there and we've seen glimpses that he can handle it. And I know Matt Burton will be an unbelievable player and he's doing some great things at the moment, but we've got to remember he's been around a team that hasn't lost that. And they're playing other teams, like they're playing the Bulldogs and they're playing teams that aren't much opposition. When you're playing the best on the best.
Yeah, it's different.
And I'm not saying he couldn't handle it because he probably could, but if I'm New South Wales and I need to win a series, I'm going to what I know.
I hope everyone's enjoying his form, because once he gets that blue and white jumper on, that's going to go out the back, door. So.
I was going to say, has Matt Burton ever lost an NRL first grade match?
He wasn't in the grand final, so was he?
I believe
did they lose last year when he played?
No. And then
he was in the draw with Newcastle because he missed about 5 field goals.
Yeah, I don't think he's lost the game. And then after next year, I don't think he'll win another game.
Matt Burton does have a single loss. Matt Burton is 13-1-1. That loss came against Parramatta 16-10.
Oh, and they were leading, with 10 to go. Yeah, okay.
Not 10-0, that's right. Anyway, only lost. Pretty good record.
I think. So, do you think that the New South Wales suffered all these years because I don't know how much you remember it. It used to be city country was selected, and then the New South Wales team was selected from that.
Yep.
And then the Australian team was selected from New South Wales Queensland games.
Yeah.
I think once teams started picking players because they want to be loyal to them, I think that sort of, for me, sort of threw it out the window. Like. You've got blokes that are playing better but don't get their position because coaches are being loyal.
Like, I hate that. It was awful under Laurie Daly in particular, where it was just this blind loyalty to a squad that lost the year before. Like, I have no idea what you're loyal to. Like why are we just going to stick with these same guys over and over and over? Like, I'm with you. Like, as a country boy, I love the city country game. Yeah, I love it almost as much as Origin back in the day.
Mm.
And I did love that you would, in the early 90s, you would find, players would just get picked because they had an absolute ripper of a game. And all of a sudden, they're playing Origin that week and a half time. Brad McKay built his career out of it. Like, Brad McKay made his mark, played for country, and then all of a sudden he's playing for New South Wales, playing for Origin. It was, different times. The halves is fascinating. Now, before we get into who we're picking, what are the thoughts on, do you need a club pairing to be your halves?
Well, normally, and I'll chime in here, sorry to be rude, but normally, and we've seen it over the years where the right-hand side deals with the right-hand side and the left-hand half deals with left-hand. The difference with the Penrith halves pairing, they actually are genuine pairing. They find each other. They go out of their way to find each other. They get the ball, they shift from left to right. Even if they're caught on a sideline, they'll get to the other sideline within one play. They're brilliant at how they don't waste any plays. They do not waste any plays in a set. Yeah. And that's because of their combination. I love it, personally. I don't think you normally need it in the traditional sense, but these guys are better than the traditional sense. They work together, and that's what I love about them.
Yep. Well, I think Teddy's trying to make a case here for Cody Walker.
He is, but I was really on the fence for this one. I can see the benefit. I think Cody Walker's a better player than Jerome Luai.
I think
that Luai works so well with Cleary. Like, normally when they go, we need to have X and Y together. We need to have Reynolds here because Cody Walker's. We want to pick Cody Walker. I think that's normally rubbish. But I totally take your point, Fisky. I think they combine so well together. Am I to assume that we've got 3 Luais and Clearys here?
Yep. And, mate, I totally agree because, I mean, I agree that I think what I said about Burton, the same I think about Luai. He's beneficiary at the moment. He's a great player and will be for a long time. But you've got to remember those forwards that are going forward for him. And he's got Matt Burton Kikau outside him, Matty Burton, Brian To'o, all these players. I mean, I think... Like you said, Luai and Cleary, as a match, would just go straight into Origin. And like Fisky said, side to side, off the cuff, just know each other so well.
Makes it easy, right? So, a month ago, I reckon I could have made a pretty compelling case that Cody Walker should have been the 5-8, but his form has fallen by the wayside since Latrell's been suspended. So,
I think the 250-point losses really have hurt his.
Well, they haven't done him any favours, that's for sure.
No, I agree. I think he's a better 5-8 than Luai, but yep. I agree with Fisky. The combination that the Panthers halves have is just so ridiculously good that it makes, as a package, I think they're better than Cleary and Walker.
And often it's not even any words said. It's just a nod and a wink. It's like Paul Mawadi at El Horner, just the old nod and wink, and I know exactly what he wants.
Yeah. Don't worry, Blake. I'll show you.
Is that why he gets lit upstairs? Speaking of which, onto the hooker role. Damien Cook was unbackable favourite at the start of the season. I reckon his price has drifted a fair bit. Anyone off the Cook wagon?
Yeah,
I jumped off last night.
Wow,
onto Appy.
Yeah, I was on Appy. I think maybe last week, and I haven't been a fan of Cookie all year. The way he's been playing, I thought the new rules for him would have been
suited him perfectly.
Yeah. Oh,
but they haven't.
I know. That's why I'm just like, I don't know. But I don't know if it's something with him or what's happening, because Souths were rolling as well. But yeah, I haven't been impressive for more year, and it wasn't until, I suppose, Uppy's come back and that connection we spoke about the halves. I think Uppy with Luai, Cleary, and then you got Teddy at the back. That spine's pretty deadly.
Yeah, I've stuck with Cook.
Yeah, I've stuck with Cook too, but geez, it's getting close.
It's getting really close, and I know. Look, South's pretty unlucky in that their middles, they're really disappointed with their
middles. Yeah, their middles are going awful. I don't blame Cook for a lot of his poor forward, to be honest. Like, they're playing off the back foot a lot at the moment.
Yeah, they miss Cam Murray big time.
Yep.
Big time. Big time. His leg speed, his ability to quick play the ball.
He's back in this week too.
Back in this week, and you might find him in my Origin side too. Might find him in a few more. The middles. We'll start with you, Blake. What are you going for your two props in your lock?
Yep, so I've gone Saifidi and Regan Campbell-Gillard starting props, because my props on the bench are going to come on, and they are the go forward, but they've got a bit of ball play in them, whereas these two are going to start the game real tough for me and get those meters and run it hard. At the back in number 13, I've got Isaiah Yeo. I think the way he's been playing with Penrith, I spoke about the combinations, and that's why I've got Uppy, Luai Cleary, and Isaiah Yeo. I think he's a link between both halves, something Cameron Murray does well with Souths, and I think, or Victor Radley was as well. He was in my team, but gone now. But I think, Isaiah Yeo will be good there.
Yeah, I've got exactly the same. I've got Campbell Gillard, Saifidi, and Isaiah Yeo starting.
I had a slight variation. I just had Dale Finucane instead of Saifidi. I've got Saifidi on my bench, but I've got Dale starting with Regan.
To be fair, you are Australia's biggest Dale Finucane fan.
I love him, mate. I love him.
I know you do.
But I've got to say one thing about Yeo, and I'm glad Blake said that link comment. Like, because previously he was probably a year or two ago, he was a bit of a plotter, Yeo, and I think he was battling injury. But that footwork he showed last week at the line,
oh,
to get through, that poke his nose through and then pick up Capewell, just brilliant footy, footy.
Does anyone have a quicker play the ball in the NRL than Yeo these days, Ella? Yeah. He can get a set rolling as well as anyone.
Yeah, so I like you say, he knows those halves well, and if they go with Coruscant, even if they don't, I think Yeo will provide value there. So that's my middle.
Paul, your middle?
I've got two out of three. I've got Campbell, Gillard, and Yeo, and I've got Payne Haas starting. I'm guessing that he's probably going to be on Blake's bench when he mentioned a couple of ball-playing impact forwards. But I think the bigger the opposition, the angrier Payne gets. So I'd like to have him on there from the start. So, yeah, Payne and Campbell, Gillard propping, and Yeo in the 13.
Yeah, fascinating. Benches will be pretty keen. Now, onto the edges. And I think we all would have had Angus Crichton in the side. And yes. Angus Crichton will be suspended now for Origin 1.
Yep.
So where are we looking at? Blake, you said you've gone left field for this one. I'm guessing the back row.
Here we go.
So my thing was based around Dave Fifita. Who's going to stop Dave Fifita? So on that left side, Frizzell's usually on the right side. I've chucked him onto the left side, back row. On that right side, I've got Tevita Pangai Jr. Now, Dave Fifita's worst game this season was against the Brisbane Broncos, I think 7 runs. I think Pangai's that person you've seen on the weekend. If you say go get someone, he's going to go get him. Now, he might not be the best side to side and things like that, but I think you can get him up for a game, and even if you get 50, 60 out of him, I think it'll be a good 50, 60. So I, as I say that, I don't think they're going to pick him there, but in my team, Pangai would be there.
Yeah, very nice. I've heard a few people kind of mention his name in dispatches there. Fisky, your edges?
Yeah, I actually went with Pangai Junior. It's a long shot. We've matched up there. I actually think he's perfect. I was tossing around his name and Madison. I just don't think Madison's going well enough personally. And so I went Pangai there, but I can't have Frizzell. I think the game's moved on from him personally. He's one of those players that throw in that loyalty basket, which probably doesn't deserve on recent form. So I went with a player that I just love at the moment. That's Liam Martin. So I've got Liam Martin and Tevita Pangai Jr. And I've got to say, one of the great mysteries of the world, why Vili Kekau is not playing for New South Wales when he's a Fiji rep, which you're allowed to play Origin. You are allowed to. So Brian Toole will play for Samoa this year. There is, you know, Teddy can play for Italy. There's no reason why Kikau doesn't play for New South Wales. I just don't know.
Isn't he Queensland?
Oh, is he coming from Townsville, isn't he?
Yeah.
He played for the Cowboys.
Played for the Cowboys, yeah.
But why he doesn't play Origin, I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't know.
I don't think he's eligible for Queensland. I'm pretty sure he's New South Wales. I know he came from up there, but I'm pretty sure, because I had a look at all the Queensland eligible players on the website earlier this morning.
How many of those were born in New South Wales, Paul? 40%?
I'm fairly sure there were only four Panthers who were eligible, and he wasn't one of them.
You've got to state your eligibility. So the guy's the question Fitzy is asking is, why hasn't he declared his eligibility?
So he's never played an Origin match. His actual first game of rugby league ever was for the Cowboys Holden Cup team in 2014. So, okay. Yeah, so he's not – I have no idea. He could actually do it. He's chosen for some reason not to, but he would be the first picked in both teams, I think. But anyway, I'm going
He's taken to it well.
Yeah, good on him. I'll go Liam Martin and Tevita Pangai Jr.
What about you, Paul?
Yeah, so in the NBA, they have a six-man award, and that goes to the guy who comes off the bench and makes the biggest impact throughout the season. I think Liam Martin is that. He's in that sort of mold. He's been doing that job for the Panthers when he has been coming off the bench, and he's made a huge impact every time he's done that. He's made a big impact when he's had to start because Capewell or someone else has been injured. So I've got Martin on the edge there with Frizzell. This is probably Frizzell's last chance for mine. I think he's been hampered by a very poor Knights pack.
A pretty poor Knights pack. He hasn't helped a whole lot.
I think that his work rate has been pretty good in that Knights pack, and he just hasn't had a lot of help from those around him. So he gets another go with me. But, yeah, Liam Martin, I think, fully deserves his spot on that side.
Would you have Liam Martin on the right, though? Because the reason I took Frizzell off the right was because I remember that Knights Gold Coast game where Frizzell was up against Fifita and he scored three tries in 20 minutes.
Yep.
So, yeah.
Martin's my man for marking for Fifita.
Sweet. Beauty.
I've also got Liam Martin in the side. I'll be playing Liam Martin. I'm a big fan of Liam Martin. We can end the gushing there. There's been plenty of it. I'm with Fisky on the Frizzell wagon. I reckon he is done as a player. Pretty keen to move on from him. And I am going a little left field here as well. I was shocked at how fewer edge options were out there. Like I tossed up Ryan Madison. I don't know he's going well enough. I am going and putting Cameron Murray on an edge. I know he's played a little bit of edge there for Souths in the past. Bit of a risk, but I think he's very reliable defensively. And I think he just adapts to the speed of the game so well. So I'm pretty happy to have Cameron Murray on the edge there. And, you know, that if it gives you another option in the middle if you need it later in the game as well. Bench. Let's have a look at the benches. Who have you gone for the benches? There's nothing more regularly changed than the New South Wales Origin bench, and there's probably about 50 options for us here. So who have you plumped for, Blake?
So I've got Whiten, number 14. Obviously, Pappenhausen, I don't think will play. He would have been my 14. The reason I got Whiten is obviously because he can cover anywhere from 1 to 7.
Yeah,
maybe even a 9, and I don't know who else. I'm sure you will have a different option, but that'll be for me. I've got Murray at 15. Now I like him. He'll be my back row in the middle, replace Isaiah Yeo, or one of those two will go out to an edge when need to be. And then I've got Payne Haas and Junior Paulo. So I've left Jake Trbojevic at number 18, and I don't know. I wanted to put him in, but I just think if we're going through the middle, I think Isaiah Yeo and Cameron Murray are faster foot speed and offer the same attacking ability.
Well, yep. Mate, I had the exact same bench. So Paulo, White, and Murray and Haas.
Sweet.
Wow. There you go. Paul?
Obviously, I've got Pepe there if he's fit in the 14 jersey. But if not, I had Matt Burton. I think he's a player who can pretty much just about cover 1 to 7 as well. So he was my number 14 if Pappy wasn't fit. Then I've got Murray, Pangai Jr. and Paulo.
Let's face it, we don't need anyone covering the one. We've got about 3 fullbacks in there.
Yeah, we are right as well.
Can I change? I want to change. You sort of swayed me there, Paul. I want to put Burton in front of Whiten.
Not a bad call, Paul.
That's a great. I didn't even think of that.
Even a stop clock tells the right time twice a day.
I can't wait for you to get back for ski.
I of course have Pappenhausen in there. He won't be there by the looks of it. So I'm happy to go with Jack Whiten. Just purely for his versatility. I've gone with Junior Paulo on the bench. I've got Payne Huss on the bench, and I am going with Ryan Madison on the bench. So don't feel great about it. Really wanted to get Finucane in there, but I just don't know about $3 million. I was tossing up kind of going Coruscant in the 14 spot as well, but yeah, it felt pretty difficult this year. I think we've got an overabundance of middles. We've got no edges. We've got an overabundance of fullbacks. And we probably have no centres. So, but what I like, honestly, with the team I put together, there's a lot of flexibility within it. If you need another half, Matt Burton can go into the half. Yeah, White can come on and do something there. Like, not sure that a pinch could play in the half. So plenty available there. Do you know what the betting is in this game, Fisky? Origin 1?
I haven't looked at it recently, actually. I'll look now.
I imagine the Blues are a fairly heavily favoured. Oh, I think they'd want to be in Queensland.
Let's talk about Melbourne for a minute, because I think the venue suits Queensland playing in Melbourne. But
if it does get played, then
yeah, will it go ahead? Yeah, it looks like a typical Origin 1 price, like about 4.5 point favourite, New South Wales, $1.55.
Classic. All you want to be in Origin 1 is on the under, and I'm Queensland.
But are they wearing those the AFL jerseys, or was that just a publicity thing? Did you see that?
I haven't seen that.
So they're wearing the AFL sleeveless singlets.
I'll tell you what, there's plenty of people calling it rugby league dead after the new rule changes, but if they start wearing AFL jerseys, it might officially be the end for me. tremendous. That might do us on the advantage. I know we're going to let you go, Blake. Thanks for joining us. We might have you on again just after Origin. We'll do a little Origin wrap-up, if that's all right with you, mate.
Yep, no worries, buddy.
Are we not getting Jared Beale? Oh, I thought he was. Sorry, did no one tell you?
Thank you. I'd believe it. I'd cop it on.
Oh, if you see Jared Beale sign up with a TOV, Mike, you know something very strange is going on.
Now we're going to say one last plump for the try promo. It's just massive. If you've got an eligible entry, you can win up to $50,000. Is that the 40,000.
Yep.
So imagine you landed and logged with Ado Carr or Tommy T or something like that. You'd be a massive runner.
Yeah, don't forget to register.
Register.
Yep, www.tabsweepstake.co.nz, guys. Anyone listening?
If you don't know where to go, hit up the guys on Twitter, hit up someone, email in. We're more than happy to show.
Yep.
Fellas, another one of the best episodes there. Great fun talking Origin. We'll get you on again soon, Blake. We'll catch everyone again next week on The Advantage Line.